All right, we move on with the topics of banking. Banking has number six will be loan banking. Guys, no more talking, okay? Okay. They all do the same thing. They want me to turn my back and then boom, right? They do that. So, number six is loan banking. Number seven will be deposit banking, and number eight is limits to, what's number eight? Anybody can take a look? Is it limits to credit expansion? Oh, on credit inflation to bank credit expand. Alright, so these are the three chapters, roughly about hopefully 3 weeks, maybe two and a half weeks. This chapter six is very short, very sweet, very easy. There's nothing really special. The real thing is over here. So, first of all, it's actually very easy to explain here today, because you guys are living through a credit boom. And credit boom is basically a time where commercial banks provide a lot of credit. It's relatively easy to borrow. A lot of people borrow money to buy a lot of things. And a credit boom results in a booming economy. Booming economy. Now, it's very easy for you to recognize a booming economy. Booming economy, there's a construction out here, there's a construction back there, there are a lot of construction trucks. It's like the weirdest thing in the world I've seen. 8 o'clock, I'm coming to work at the university. And on the way, there's a nice, let's say, Korean restaurant. There are like 20 cars parked in front of the restaurant. So we got a luxury restaurant, full in the morning, full in the afternoon, full in the evening. In a booming economy, restaurants are full all the time. Bars, clubs, discos, markets, shopping mall. A booming economy is characterized by having a hard time to park at the shopping mall because the parking's already full. Now, when I was in Bulgaria during the 2006-07 booming economy, again, we had a massive credit boom, massive real estate construction. You want to go to a restaurant for lunch? Impossible. You gotta make a reservation, okay? Restaurants are cool. You want to go Saturday and Sunday to your beach? Next to impossible. You know, as soon Friday comes close to an end, you got this massive, like kilometers and kilometers of cars all going in the direction of the mountain or in the direction of the beach. So, it's like suddenly during the weekend, the whole capital is moving out one way or moving out another way. So, you got, in a booming economy, everything goes like crazy, you know. Everybody's buying new phones, everybody's buying new computers, everybody's buying new houses, everybody's opening shops, everybody's opening restaurants, everything's full, everything basically, the economy is out of control. Well, the booming economy is driven by a credit boom. And the credit book is given by, oops, that's a little thing, by bank credit. In other words, everything's on credit, you know, buy a house and all this kind of stuff. Remember, all you need is one person to borrow $100,000 to buy a house, which was on construction, okay, so they buy the house or they buy the condo, doesn't matter. Now the construction company gets $100,000. What's the construction company gonna do? They're gonna pay their workers, the workers are gonna go, they're gonna go buy beer, they're gonna go drink, they're gonna do whatever they do, restaurants, whatever they do. They're gonna make a profit, so the owner of the construction company is gonna buy them a brand new car. Now, why I'm talking about booming economy, because people are stuck either at the restaurant or they're stuck at the road. Well, booming economy is characterized by traffic jams. Traffic jam is a very common characteristic of a booming economy. And you get the traffic jams in New York and Washington, D.C. Sure, you get them in London, and of course you get them pretty much anywhere in the world that you got a booming economy. So traffic jams are very characteristic. Also, try parking, well, maybe you have, at the little mall over here, next to Impossible, all right? Then, I'm going on the weekend to the mall, same thing. It's like 1 kilometer away, traffic is stuck, everybody waiting to get in the mall, right? That's all driven by bank credit and by credit boom, okay? Well, that's the easy part. I don't need to teach you that. You know that better than me. Here's what I need to teach you. That's the hard part that very few people understand. It's why the credit boom must end. Why the credit boom cannot go on forever. Can't we just live in it? Crazy boom where we're just gonna go to restaurants and vacations? Well, the short answer is no, it's impossible. It doesn't work. You can't do that. The banks can't do that. The central bank can't do that. And that's where chapter 8 is about. And chapter 6 and chapter 7 is about how do we get the credit boom. So, in chapter 6, we begin how regular banking turns into credit booms. And eventually, number 8 is why the credit boom can't last forever. In other words, when the credit boom turns into a bust, bust is a rapid decline in the economy, and you'll see roads half empty. After 2008, in my home country, you don't see the traffic jams anymore. The roads aren't as full. Restaurants, it's very easy to go anywhere and the restaurants will not be full. You don't see a concept of full restaurant. The mall is not full. You don't have to wait anywhere. You can go anywhere on vacation and the restaurants will be free, you know, the housing, everything, hotels will be all open. So in a credit bust, the economy slows down and everything in the boom goes into reverse, okay? It means, well, you don't need the latest phone anyway. If you got iPhone 5, you don't need 6. If you got 6, you don't need 7. If you got the last, the late, the previous MacBook, you don't need the new MacBook. So booms turn into busts. That's the next fundamental concept. And this, the boom and the bust, is called the economic cycle. The economy goes down, and the economy goes up, and then it goes down. Housing prices go up, and then housing prices go down. Everybody who bought a lot of houses become basically losers. Many people would actually lose their house to the bank. And if it's only losing the house to the bank, that's the easy part. The really hard part is that a lot of people will lose their money in the bank. In other words, there will be tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people having money in the bank, and the money is not in the bank. That's what I'm going to be discussing in chapter 7. Chapter 7 is that if you think you have a deposit in the bank, the deposit is not there. While people think that it is, that's the illusion. Alright, so let's focus today on the economic cycle. We'll also call it business cycle, and a lot of times it's called the credit cycle. Now, one of the main ideas that we'll study, you have to learn and understand in this course, is that the credit cycle drives the economic and the business cycle. Credit goes up, the economy and the business go up. Credit goes down, the economy and the business usually crashes pretty quickly. And the idea is why credit can't go on. Can't we just keep borrowing forever? All right. So, again, bank, very, very unclear what it is. And we have now what we call modern banking. Modern banking is what is known today as commercial banking. And commercial banking is basically the merger of loan banking with deposit banking, with some evil effects that, again, I'll be explaining in 7 and 8. Let's discuss the easy part, which is just loan banking. Loan banking is fairly straightforward. I open up my own bank, I put in $10,000 of my money, and then you want a loan for $1,000, I give you a loan for $1,000. You want to, let's say, buy a computer for $500, I loan you $500. You want to buy something, let's say, motorcycle for $2,000, I loan you money for $2,000. So, loan banking has the important function of channeling savings. These are money which I have saved, and they're channeled for other purposes. They may be channeled for business purposes. We call this a business loan, or they may be for consumption purposes. For example, you buy yourself a motorcycle, you buy yourself a loan, which becomes a consumer loan or consumption loan. You can have both. All right. So, loan banking. Now I'm moving on to page 76. Did you guys study already accounting or not yet? Okay, well, in accounting, you have what is known as a T account. So, T account. Did you start already T accounts? It's just the letter T. It's just the letter T. This is the letter T, okay? And the T account got a left side. We call this left hand side. Again, left hand side is this part over here, and this is the left hand side, and this is the right hand side. So this is a basic T account. On the one side you have what we call assets, and on the right hand side you have what we call
liabilities.
Alright. So, we have the phenomenon of what is known, that one of the greatest inventions of the Middle Ages, like 500-700 years ago, is called double entry bookkeeping. Every transaction always affects two accounts. Always affects two accounts. Sometimes it will affect two asset accounts. Sometimes it will affect two liabilities account. But a lot of times it will affect one particular asset and one particular liability. Okay? So, that's double entry bookkeeping. Single entry was the old way how you write. Now I see, for example, when I was in Thailand, they'll do their little accounting, where every person will do his little accounting, they have a nice little book, and it's going to be single entry. All they're going to do is, this person so much money, this person so much money, this person so much money. That's a single entry. In a double entry, you only don't want to see the money, but when you see where the money came from, or how it came, was it a revenue, was it borrowed, what happened? Was it the owner put in the money? Did he just borrow the money? Did the customer give you the money? You know, where the, so if you have money coming in, you will also record where the money came from. So that's the double-sided nature of it. Okay. So on the left side, the right side, okay. Now on the this side here, you're gonna have two parts. The one part will be liabilities. And liabilities is money which is borrowed, you owe. And the other part is called equity. And equity is money which the owners put, money which the owners put. Equity is also called capital. So sometimes we say equity, sometimes we say owner's equity, sometimes we say equity capital. So you can use the word equity, you can use the word capital. A lot of times you join them together, it's called equity capital. Why we don't just use the word capital? Because capital is a very confusing word. When you have a, let's say, a little restaurant, your capital will be the tables, will be the cooking equipment. So sometimes people think of the assets as their capital, which is technically incorrect. The long-term assets are not capital. Capital is a source of financing. So liabilities give you the sources of financing, and sources of financing could be liability, meaning creditors, and equity, meaning owners. Okay, let's see what else we got now. Assets, liabilities, okay. Alright, so now we go through again. This thing is very simple the way we do the accounting here, because accounting for banking, for simple standard, especially loan banking, is very simple. There's nothing really complicated. So let me open a bank. I can open my bank. We can open in the textbook will be the Rothbard bank. Okay. And how much is the Rothbard bank? How much capital does it have? Can anyone take a look and see? That's page Rothbard Bank. Page 77. What's the bank? Rothbard puts $10,000. So, yeah, cash. $10,000, and then you have, is it equity or capital? How to say?
Equity.
Equity. 10,000. So when you establish the bank, there are no liabilities in the sense there are no obligations. And that's pretty much the bank. This is what the bank looks like. Now, if you like, you can do just like in the textbook and say total assets 10,000, total liabilities 10,000. Okay, I'll save the total part. Okay, all you do is add things up. Well, now what's the next step? So, page 77, you see the first chart, figure that's bigger, 6-1. All you do is establish the bank, meaning you put in $10,000 in the business, nothing more, nothing less. Now, step number one, that's page 77 at the very bottom, and it says, suppose you lend, that's the last sentence at the very bottom of page 77, you lend $9,000 to Joe Diner. So, you make a business loan. So, let me see where it is. 6-2. Figure 6-2. Business loan. Now, here your cash is how much? The cash? Cash should be, if I remember, 1,000, and loan, you can call it business loan, or you can call it loan Joe Diner. Okay, loan Joe Diner is 9,000. That's the assets and the equity again is 10,000. Now, notice total assets were 10,000, total assets are again 10,000. We convert one asset of cash, we convert it into another asset, 9,000 loan and cash, equity all remained the same. That's it. This is the loan, and that's how you record the loan. Now, recording the loan, you'll say debit loan 9,000 and credit cash 9,000. Okay, but all you need to do is not see the debit and credit, just see the new balance sheet. Now I got cash and now I got loan. All right, let's see what happens then. So, all that we do here is this transaction is basically cash transfer. Cash transfer. I transfer $9,000 of my bank money and give it to the borrower. That's all of it. He took the cash and however he spent it on his diner. So that's the only thing that happened. Now, what we need to notice in this transaction is number one. When I made a loan and the loan was used, let's say, as a business loan, this is productive. Productive in the sense that the money which I have saved, we say over there, I wrote it somewhere, you channel over here. You channel savings, meaning savings comes from me to a business owner who will use it as a, what we call, business investment. He'll buy machine, equipment, tables, he'll clean, he'll do whatever. So, number one, it is productive, and number two, very, very important, is non-inflationary. Non-inflationary in the sense that money supply is constant. Money supply did not change. You did not increase the money supply, did not decrease the money supply. So $9,000 of my money became your money. My money went down by 9,000 and your money went up by 9,000. All we did was transferred cash from one person to another, but the total amount of money remained the same. That's very simple, very straightforward. Okay. Well, number two. So, number two. Next. Consumption loan. Do they have here the guy returning money back? Oh yeah, they got the money. The guy returning money back. Okay, let's do first the guy returning money back, and then we do the next one. So after 1 year, Joe Diner will pay money back. How much is the interest? The interest is $900, right? So the guy will pay us money back. He'll pay us 9,000 plus the 900 cash. So our cash becomes 1,000 plus 9 is 10,000 plus the 9,000 interest is 10,900. That's our cash. And what's the equity? The equity is interest goes to profit, goes to equity. So equity is again 10,900. Now, my money increased after 1 year by 900. But here's the trick. Joe Diner's money reduced by 900. So here, mine was down by 9,000. His was up by 9,000. Now he paid me back 9,900. Mine is up by net 900, and his is down by net 100. Well, where did Joe get the money from? Well, he got it from his business. He ran a diner. You gave him, so he made an investment. He had services, he had customers, he had people in. He generated a profit. It came out of his profit. So essentially it was productive, but my money now increased by 900 and his money supply was down by 900. But where he got his money supply? He got it from the other customers. In other words, customers spent money in his restaurant and he made a profit. Again, the same concept of non-inflationary and productive. So now let's do a consumption law. Textbook doesn't have anything, but we can do exactly the same thing. Yeah, now cash 10,900 will become 5,900 and loan for 5,000. So you make a consumer loan. Want to make a consumer loan? The equity remains exactly the same. Okay. And a consumer, let's say, pays you, let's say, only $100 in, only $100 they may pay you in interest. Your new cash will be 11,000, and your new equity will be 11,000. Again, you increase your balance by the interest that you collect. That's all that you do. And the consumer, let's say he borrowed 5,000, after 1 month or after 2 months, he paid you back 5,100. All he did was pay interest. Well, where did the consumer get the money? He got the money from his income, from his job. He worked, he was productive there, so he earned money, and he pays you interest because you gave him the money to borrow so he can enjoy the house or the car or the phone or whatever the consumer used the loan for. Maybe he just used it for vacation. Doesn't matter. The point is, again, the same one. Somehow the user used it productively, the consumer used it productively. They enjoyed the benefit, and at the same time, it was non-inflationary. So that's a consumer loan. Next one is, I'm seeing here, again, it's, let's write another non-inflationary, productive, let's write a third one. Applies both to the consumer and producer. Mutually beneficial.
name fee.
Mutually beneficial means that both the lender benefit and the borrower benefit. The borrower can develop their business, or they can buy the car that they wanted, or whatever they wanted to do.
So it's mutually beneficial.
Next one is, at the very bottom is partners, adding partners, page 79. So the old balance was, in that particular case, 10,900. He's throwing in a partner. So he puts in his brother or his brother-in-law. And that's gonna be 6-4. So, you have a cash of 10,900. You get a partner, the partner is 50-50. He will put in cash 10,900. Now you have equity Rothberg, okay, that's 10,900, and equity brother-in-law, okay, 10,900. Now, you can put in for whatever the brother-in-law, if you put in 5,000, you put in 5,000 extra here, okay? So, total cash is now, what is it, 21,800, and total equity is 21,800. Again, when you throw in an extra partner, loan banking is again non-inflationary. And number two, what's number two? Productive. Productive in the sense that now the partner can benefit from the next loan too. It's non-inflationary because yes, your cash balance increased by 10,900, but your partner's cash balance was reduced. All you did was, again, the same thing. A cash transfer from the partner, we call it, into the bank partnership. That's all that happens. Nothing really simple, fairly straightforward. All right. Now, again, no changes. The next step is, so this is a partner. Partner, and you're forming partnership. Very similar is the accounting when you do a, let me draw up, draw here, red line so it's easier to see. Now, exactly the same thing happens when you have a corporation. You can form a corporation. Let's see what are the terms of the corporation. Equity shareholders. Let me see where he got this. Oh, he loaned some money. Okay, so that's what said. Sell 10,000 shares at $10 a piece. Okay, so you sell, I'm reading here, 10,000 shares. 10,000 shares, that's the number of shares multiplied by $10. What's the bank if you make it a corporation? Cash, 100,000. Equity, 100,000. Now this corporation obviously makes some kind of a loan. Rothbard loan corporation and whatnot. And for example, you make a loan. You make a 95,000 loan, again the same thing. Cash becomes 5,000. Loan becomes 95,000. The equity is 100,000. Again, it's the same idea. When you form a corporation, shareholders put in money, $10 per share. The total amount of cash you collect is $100,000. Again, whether it's a corporation or a partnership, or in this particular case, let's write it out here. We call this proprietorship. Proprietorship is a business owned by a single owner. The single owner is called proprietor. Here, partnership is owned by two or more partners, and a corporation is a legal entity which sells shares, and each share represents a particular percentage, in this case, 1/10,000 of the ownership. So ownership is represented by the number of shares that you own. So whether you have a proprietorship, whether you have a partnership or a corporation, the accounting remains the same. In other words, the legal form of the bank doesn't matter. As long as you're making loans, the loan making is exactly the same, and the loan making again is non-inflationary and productive at the same time. Very simple, fairly straightforward. So once you have, let's say, corporation, now you can borrow money. And I'll be explaining next time, there's a big, big, big difference between borrowing money, where people lend money to the bank, and depositor money, where people put the money in the bank. There's like a huge difference. So now you have a bank borrowing. Now, why would the bank borrow money? It will borrow money so that it can re-lend that money. The trick in borrowing money is that you borrow at 5% and lend at 8%. Okay, so you have what's called a borrowing rate. Borrowing rate is the interest rate that you pay on borrowing money. And then you have a lending rate, which is the interest rate that you collect on making loans. And then the difference between these two is called the interest rate differential. Interest, I will shorten it, interest rate differential. Differential means difference between these two things. So here's the difference between the borrowing rate and the lending rate. So if the borrowing rate is 5%, the lending rate is 8%, the interest rate differential is 3%. As a bank, you can collect the difference of 3%. So now we're getting into simple banking. The question is, why a bank will collect the differential? Why the bank can make the differential? Number one, some basic economic reasons. The bank specializes. When the bank specializes, if there are 20 borrowers who want to borrow money from me, and I'm the bank, I'll give the loan to you because you're the best borrower. Your ability to borrow money and ability to pay back the money, because everyone can borrow. You can borrow as much and you can borrow 10 times more. The question is not how much you can borrow. That's not the question. The question is, can you pay back what you can borrow? It's, are you able to pay back? Well, that ability to pay back, I'll write it up here, is called credit wordiness. Credit worthy is someone who's worthy of a credit, someone who deserves a credit. Credit worthy means a person who is able, capable of handling debt and paying back the debt. So credit worthy means two things. Means number one, you're able to generate income. You actually make money. But making the money is not enough. The trick is, after you make the money, you're not gonna drink the money and then don't have money to pay. Is when you make the money, you're able to save and pay back the loan. So this ability is called credit worthiness. Is the ability of a person to generate income and savings to pay back their loans. So, you specialize in evaluating and lending to the most creditworthy person, those who are most likely to pay back the loan. Okay? So, first, I evaluate maybe 10 borrowers and give a credit to one or two. I give credit to the best creditworthy borrower. So, I have to make a judgment. Because knowing who can pay or who cannot pay, you need to evaluate job, income, assets, but you also need to evaluate the character. Is this guy gonna just go on vacation and not being able to pay? Is this guy just gonna drink the money or spend it on bars or whatever they do? Or they're gonna be good and conscientious, okay, about the loan. So that's the specialization. And the second part is eventually some borrowers will not be able to pay. So I'm actually taking a credit risk. Now the specialization applies to the bank over there as a proprietorship, it applies as a partnership, it applies to the corporation. The credit risk applies to all three again. In other words, I'm making money based on my risk. Sometimes borrowers don't pay. Sometimes borrowers disappear. They go in another country, okay? They don't come back. You never see them. And sometimes borrowers just plain die for whatever reason. They get into a motorcycle, a car accident. People get sick, okay? These things do happen in the real world. So specialization is the next thing. So, when you have borrowing, let me see what I'm gonna write again. So when you have a basic, let's say, corporation, and the corporation borrows money, here they have, let me see where they have it, the profit differential. Okay, so yeah, bonds. Okay, so how do you borrow money? Okay, we're getting a little bit into banking. And of course, we're going to get a whole lot more. I'm just trying to make a simple point. All right, so we had cash, my equity is 20,000, so equity 20,000. You can borrow by issuing a bond, and a bond is simply a loan which has a fixed interest rate. Again, we'll discuss this in the second half, bond markets. You just borrow money, you issue a bond. And the bond is just a debt, let's say 50,000. So you got from the bond 50,000 and a CD 20,000, which you get a cash for 20,000. Now I'm going to switch the pens. Here's CD stands for certificate of
deposit.
A bank will usually give a certificate for a deposit of what we call in banking time deposit. Now, I'll be explaining next time a lot more when we get to depositing. A time deposit is not a deposit in a bank. A time deposit is a loan to the bank for a particular period of time. So it will be a 3-month loan. You're lending the money to the bank pays you interest on your money for 3 months, maybe they pay you 2-3% for those 3 months, and you cannot take your money back before the 3 months. Now the CD could be a 1-year CD, they'll just pay you, let's say, 7%, or they'll pay you 10%. So a time deposit is not a deposit, it is a loan to the bank for a fixed period of time, and the depositor cannot withdraw the money early. That certificate of deposit is just shortened and say CD. So you issue CDs for $20,000, usually the CD will be $1,000 rounded. If you get $2,000, you buy 2 CDs, okay, just a piece of paper. So my total cash here will be $90,000, and my total liabilities plus equity will be again $90,000. So when the bank borrows money, the bond savers will transfer a cash balance to you. All we do, again, is the same thing which I just deleted. It's simple cash transfer. And in return, they get a bond. The bond will pay interest every 3 months or every 6 months or every year, usually every 6 months, okay? Now, the CD does not pays interest only at the end. So when you buy a, let's say, $1,000 CD, you pay $900, and after 12 months you get $1,000. So in the meantime, the CD does not pay interest. It pays interest only at the very end. And it's the same cash transfer. Let's see where I'm finishing today. Wow, man, I got like half a page, one page left to finish the chapter. Chapter went about half a page. All right, so we got the CDs and it's the same thing. Okay, the bank is a loan expert, that's the same thing. When the bank makes a loan, the cash becomes $50,000. The loan becomes, hey guys, 2 more minutes, 1 more minute and I'm gonna be done. Again, it's the same thing. So debt here is $70,000, equity here is $20,000. All we're doing is transfer from money from bondholders to the bank, from the bank to the borrower. Again, the same story of that it is non-inflationary and productive. This is very similar to 6-7. 6-7, table 6-7 on page 83. It's just the bank is a little different. Here, the bank has a cash of $5,000. And the IOUs are 165, the bonds and the CDs are 70, and the equity is $100,000, okay? So here, the equity is $100,000, here the cash is, what is it, 5 and 165. Total assets are 170, total liabilities are 170. Again, let's see what else. If the loans are not paid back, okay, we lose some equity. The bank is said to be insolvent. Insolvent is a financial institution, actually any business whose equity turns negative, or, which is the same thing, whose liabilities exceed the assets. If they exceed the assets, this means there is no way for you to pay back your debts. Okay? So, a bank can turn insolvent, and insolvency will result in bankruptcy. So, the bank makes a loan, the loan goes bad. Bad loan is when the borrower does not pay back the money and the bank cannot collect the money. So, in a bad loan, you lose equity. If you make enough bad loans, you become insolvent and results in bankruptcy. Bankruptcy is a proceeding where all assets are liquidated and liabilities are satisfied. So, you sell all assets and you pay back all the liabilities. That's a bankruptcy. It's a legal proceeding. Again, when you have a bad loans, it just means that the bank lost, the borrower never paid back. Whether they pay or not pay, it's all non-inflation. This is simple, basic, straightforward. There's nothing really interesting. The interesting part comes when you mix loan banking with deposit banking, which we'll be discussing in about 3 lectures, maybe 4 lectures. First, we discuss deposit banking alone, and then how it works together with loan banking. All right, that's all. Thank you very much. Let's see the attendance, traffic jams, right?